أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما محمد إلا رسول قد خلت من قبله الرسل أفإن مات أو قتل انقلبتم على أعقابكم ومن ينقلب على عقبيه فلن يضر الله شيئا وسيجزي الله الشاكرين وما كان لنفس ان تموت الا باذن الله كتابا مؤجلا ومن يرد ثواب الدنيا نؤته منها ومن يرد ثواب الاخره نؤته منها وسنجزي الشاكرين Verses 145 and 146. The translation in the one volume commentary is as such: And Muhammad is but a messenger. Verily, all messengers have passed away before him. If then he dies or is slain, will you turn back on your heels? And he who turns back on his heels shall not harm Allah at all, and Allah will certainly reward the grateful. And no soul can die except by Allah's leave, a decree which He fixed with a fixed term. And whoever desires the reward of the present world, we will give him thereof, and whoever desires the reward of the hereafter, we will give him thereof. And we will surely reward the grateful. I'm sorry to have missed the verse yesterday, so I'll be able only perhaps to cover the first verse during this verse and not the second one, because the discussion on the first verse, which I have just recited, perhaps would take longer time and we'll be hardly able to finish it in 1 hour's time. So the last hour, half hour, has to be devoted for question and answer. Let me first discuss the meaning in depth of some important words used here. Khala yakhlu khuluwum wa khalaan. Khala yakhlu is the inflection. Somebody passed and someone would pass away. Khala yakhlu. Khuluwan wa khalan are the infinitives of this three-lettered word. It all depends on which preposition is used in conjunction with the use of khala, which gives different meanings and connotations to the same central meaning. Khalal makano means somebody vacated the house. Akhlal makana, someone vacated a place or found it vacated. Al khilwo means something which is empty and void. Al-khala'u refers to an open, deserted place. Al-khali'u is also has the connotation of somebody who is without wife. Al-khilwu is a compliment for a person who is without any fears or worries. So, khali in the sense that he's empty of worries and problems. Khalar rajulo means somebody who went to a private place with someone to have a private word or to be alone with somebody in some place. So, khala, ma, with somebody, would mean somebody went away and to a secluded place or private place, or met someone in privacy, shall we say. Khala fiha nazir is an expression used by the Holy Quran with reference to the past peoples. The Holy Quran repeatedly points out that you can see that in the past many people have been warned by God, and there is no people on earth to whom we did not send a warner. So khala fiha nazir, a warner, went to them, lived with them, and passed away with them. All these three meanings are contained in this expression. Khala fulanun, if it is used without any other proposition, without any positive indication to have a different sense, just use the word khala as applicable to a human being, it would always mean death. Khala fulanun, he passed away, he died. So if it is used without prepositions, without a very specific context which would indicate different meanings, khala would mean death and nothing else. So you can say khala bil makane. Here the word be is the preposition which gives a different meaning to the word. Now you can well understand it in with reference to other languages as well. For instance, past is the literal translation of the word khala. In English, when you say someone passed away, you never permit yourself to believe that he passed by London or by another city or by you or from one place to another. When you use just the general expression passed away, it always means in death and nothing else. In Urdu, we use the word guzar gaya. When you say wo yahan se guzar gaya, he passed from this place, then obviously it doesn't mean he died. When you say yahan se guzar kar wahan chala gaya, he left this place, khala this place and went to another place, this means he just shifted from one place to another. But whenever you say wo guzar gaya, it always means death. So many ulama who used to come to meet to discuss such issues with me, I always, not always but often, ask them this question, aapke walid sahib hayat hain ya guzar gaye hain? Hayat hain is a Punjabi expression for somebody who is alive. Guzar gaye is a literal translation of khala. So if they were dead, he would always say guzar gaye. So that is exactly how the word khala is used in Arabic. Khala lil amre. Le is a preposition which gives a new connotation to the word khala. It means that somebody has devoted his time entirely for one particular purpose. Khala for this. He relieved himself of all other responsibilities and cares and dedicated his time and attention to one particular thing. That would be indicated by the word khala. So also there are other uses, but I think that should be enough. Now as far as this, just the simple use of the word khala is concerned, I quote a few authentic dictionaries of Arabic, like Al-Munjad, Lisanul Arab, Akhrabul Mawarid, Tajul Urus. They all are agreed, united on this, that khala fulanun always means iza mata, khala rajulu ay mata, Khala fulanun e mata. It means he died, he died, he died, he died. Qalaba yaqlibu qalbam wa qallaba. Qallaba thawba. Qalaba means to change, to turn, to reverse. Yaqlibu, to do the same things in future. The infinitive is qalban, and the past is qallaba. Qalaba or qallaba as well. Both are used. Qalaba means something which turned himself, but also it is used as transitive. Qallaba is definitely for transitive. Qallaba thawba, somebody turned the cloth inward, outwards from the inside. Ilahi tuqlaboon, towards Allah will you be turned. Al-inqilab also is derived from the same infinitive, which means the revolutions, everything has changed completely. So inqalabtum ala aqabikum means to turn back, not only to run away, but to turn back to your original faith. So it also has the meaning of irtidad in this sense, that will you run away will be applicable to only those who temporarily, out of the shock of hearing Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's death, just could not hold their places, could not hold themselves or could not keep themselves in battle, and in panic, just a panic or deep shock, I should say, they just started dispersing here and there or running away. But the fuller meaning of the word inqalabtum ala aqabikum, which is perhaps mainly intended, is to turn back to your old faith, your old state of ignorance. And that is what was primarily suggested by many hypocrites, that Prophet Muhammad died, so turn back. Or he really met his death, so also prophets do not meet such disgrace, they thought. They can't even approach death according to their concept of prophethood. So they said, now turn back. So I think this is the primary intention for the usage of this word. All the commentators, classical commentators, are agreed on the background of this verse. That is well known to you by now. It relates to the time in Uhud. According to Zamashkari, Imam Razi, Allama Ulusi, Shawkani, Qurtubi, etc., etc., Imam Razi and many others, well, they all say that when Ibn Qamiya announced that he had killed Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this caused a panic in the army of the Muslims, and although they had already been injured and their number had been depleted by the sudden counter attack, that was not what caused the running away and scattering of the Muslim army. This was the main reason why. So this should be well understood, because to run away from battle is unthinkable in Islam. It's a crime of the most heinous nature. So when God talks of forgiving them, they could not have escaped for their lives. And this point proves the assertion that they did not escape for their lives despite the successful counterattack. They lost hope and faith, lost hope when they heard that Rasulullah had died, they lost a purpose for that battle. And they were so confused and confounded with the shock of the news that they were not in a fit frame of mind to coolly consider the implications of what they were doing. So that must have been the reason why all those except for the followers of Abdullah bin Ubay bin Sulul have been mentioned in the Quran as having been forgiven, and there's no blame on them. Because of course overwhelming love of Ahadra sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was at the crux of the matter. It was the main motive force for their escape, which was not good, but it could be turned to another purpose, like we hear Hazrat Anas bin Nadr. When he inquired from somebody who was running away in panic, he said, "What's happened?" He said, "Ahlul has been murdered." So he said, "Well then, he has reached his goal. Will you tarry behind? So this is the time now to follow him to the better life which he already has reached." So this reasoning quality cannot be shared by ordinary people. This was a special gift of Hazrat Anas bin Nadr, and there were many others like him, but the majority could not reason out what had happened and what they should do as a consequence. Now, as far as that is concerned, this issue is not taken up by the Holy Quran, because it is considered minor and irrelevant as compared to the reaction of the non-believers, the Jews and the Christians, the pagans, and particularly of the hypocrites. They started campaigning against the truth of Ahadith sallallahu alaihi wasallam by maintaining that a prophet does not meet such ends. And immediately when the news reached Medina, before the second news reached the Medina that Ahasuerus was well and alive, there was a time lapse in which these things must have been said. And that should have been for a very short while, because the verse treats not with the near death, the question of near death, but the question of death itself. So after Rasulullah returned to Medina safely, we can understand the trend of their talk. But that is not what the Holy Quran is referring to. The Holy Quran is referring to a period where they were inciting others to rebel against Islam, the Muslims, and the weak among them, because the news had reached them that Ahasuerus had gave up his life in the battlefield. And that is the most important issue this verse is taking up. Ma Muhammadun illa Rasul is the argument, the first part of the argument which is being built and developed. Muhammad, whatever his greatness, whatever his status with his Lord, Hazrat Allah Jalla Shanuhu, is still a man and a prophet. Man is implied, is not mentioned, but when all Rusul are men, so that is why I said man, because it's already implied. And every believer confesses that Ahasuerus is no more than a prophet, whatever his status. All right. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلِ. All the prophets before him have passed away, without fail, without exception. This is a categorical statement which leaves no room for exception. Because if even there is a suggestion of an exception, then the argument would collapse. The argument can only be varied in totality. Reimagine the situation. People are talking about the death of Ahasuerus, and are claiming that because he has died, so he could not be a true prophet. The answer is, he is a prophet and no more than a prophet. As far as the fates of the earlier prophets is concerned, all of them have passed away. None is alive. Not to leave no room for any other suggestion, the Holy Quran further explains the meaning of khala, the word khala, because there would be many mullahs born in the future who, despite this very total and positive assertion of the Quran, would try to wriggle out of this situation and claim that Jesus Christ is still an exception. He's not died. So that is why the Holy Quran is very firm and round and would not let anybody escape and run away with a false idea. So it says, Afaim Mata O Kutila. As a consequence of khala, if he dies a natural death or is murdered, anqalabtum ala aqabikum, will you have a right to turn back on your feet? So the situation demands that the emphasis should be considered to be on irtidad, renegation, turning back to one's old faith. Now the question is, now this statement is now developed into this full argument. Because Muhammad was, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was no more than a prophet, because all prophets before him, without fail, without exception, have passed away, so Prophet Muhammad also is liable to pass away in two ways only. By natural death or by murder. There is no third way suggested. So that means khala covers only two possibilities. The manner of khala, how would it be? Have they passed away by vacating the world bodily, like they claim Jesus did, or by some other means? The Holy Quran specifies the translation of the khala by suggesting only two means. Either natural death or murder, no third way. And now when you look back at the history of the prophets, this is exactly what happened to them. So there is no room whatsoever for any sensible and honest man to continue to believe in Jesus' life after the revelation of this verse. Before this was revealed, he must have passed away. So it says, وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ. After this statement, it is declared that whoever turns back on his feet, on his heels, فَلَنْ يُدُرَ اللَّهَ شَيَىٰ, he will not hurt the cause of Allah, any. وَسَيَزِّ اللَّهُ شَاكِرِينَ, and God rewards amply those who are grateful. There is another verse using the same word khala with reference to another prophet. I'll come to that later. Now I quote a very important hadith which is related by Bukhari in Kitab al-Maghazi, which relates to the incident of actual passing away of Ahmad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he did ultimately pass away. When this verse was recited by Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, how and when it happened, this will further help us understand the true meaning of this verse and its import. It is reported from Hazrat Abba ibn Abbas that on the day of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's demise, Abu Bakr came out from visiting him, And while he came out, he saw Umar talking to a group of people, companions of Rasulullah. He was saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has not died. When Abu Bakr heard this, he commanded Umar to sit down, and that is to say, leave the room for him to address the people. He refused to do that. So Abu Bakr, despite that, started addressing the people at a loud voice, and what he said was, after praising Allah and sending salam and salat on Allah, he said, whoever worshipped Muhammad, so remember, now you should learn that your God is dead. Whoever worshipped Muhammad, he should be aware that Muhammad is no more, he is dead. But whoever worshipped Allah, for he is everlasting and he will never die. What a beautiful opening to that speech, a speech of all ages, I must say. We have no Shakespeare to dramatize this event, but it's a beautiful speech, very hard-hitting, precise, correct, to the point, and overwhelmingly logical, who just completely changed the climate that was created by Hazrat Umar's assertion that Hazrat Rasulullah could never die, he is not dead. And this was the demand of every lover at that moment. To turn the tide was a great achievement of Hazrat Abu Bakr indeed, no doubt. Then he recited this verse, according to this tradition, up to Ash-Shakirin, the full verse. Ma Muhammadun illa Rasul. The strongest argument he could put forward in favor of his claim that Rasulullah is dead, said, Ma Muhammadun illa Rasul, Muhammad was nothing but a prophet. Qad khalat min qablihi Rasul. All prophets before him had died. Afaim ma ta'u qatala. So likewise, he also died or was murdered, what right have you got to turn back? Now the reaction of the people who heard this verse has been described by the narrator of this hadith. He says, as if, although this verse was well known to everybody, but the Ravi, the reporter, says that as if it was for the first time that the verse was revealed. We never knew the true meaning of this verse until Hazrat Abu Bakr recited it in context with the Prophet's demise. And then this became the fashion of the day. Everybody learned this verse, those who had not learned it before, and in the streets of Medina and everywhere the Sahaba went, they kept on reciting this, Ma Muhammadun illa Rasul, Qad khalat min qabli Rasul. The streets of Medina were resounding with the sound of this verse, being recited repeatedly and often by those who travelled, and even in the homes this was recited. He says there was not one single exception. All prophet, all companions of the Prophet, and even those who were not companions, who he refers perhaps to the children, because they had not reached the age of companionship. Otherwise, he couldn't have said there was no companion. All the people who lived in Medina were companions, that is to say the Muslims, except the children of younger age. But it seems this became so popular that even the small children started reciting this verse. Let me read the original text. فَمَا أَسْمَى بَشَرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ إِلَّا يَتْلُوهَا. You know, I wanted to be sure whether the narrator used the word Sahabi or non-Sahabi, or the translator has explained it on his own. So that is why I found it necessary to read the original text. In the original text, he does not enter the debate of somebody being a Sahabi or not Sahabi at all. What he says is, فَتَّلَقَّهَا مِنْهُ النَّاسُ كُلُّهُمْ فَمَا أَسْمَعَ بَشْرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ إِلَّا يَتْلُوهَا. All people learnt it from Abu Bakr, and without exception, everyone who did so, all people started reciting this verse from then on. Now, the end part. فأخبرني سيد بن المسيب أن عمر قال والله ما هو إلا أن سمعت أبا بكر تلاها فأقرت حتى ما تقلني رجلي وحتى أهويت إلى الأرض حين سمعته تلاها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قد مات. It's very important. The message received by Hazrat Umar himself, who is the leader of those who said Rasulullah would never die, he is still alive. He says, when I heard this, what happened to me was, I swooned, my knees went lifeless. They could no longer hold my weight. Hatta ahvaito, until I completely passed out. Ilalarde, until I fell down to the floor. Hina sameto talaha, when I heard him recite, anna nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qad mata. So the meaning which dawned upon Hazrat Umar, and which left no room for any other meaning or interpretation, were explained by him in one single word, mata. So mata has no other connotation. It's a very positive, clear declaration of somebody's death. And that is why afaim mata is used. But here Hazrat Umar says, when he recited the verse, he announced the death of Hazrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, for any sensible, reasonable, honest man, this verse leaves no room for any other interpretation but to believe in the death of Hazrat Jesus Christ. Now, the question arises, why people before Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, who were honest, who were sensible, who were devoted to the cause of Islam, still believed in this while they read this verse? Abul Kalam, Sir Sayyid Ahmad has presented this excuse for them. He said, sometimes you inherit some view or thought and you are given up to it, and you are not awakened to realize the contrary. So the ulama of the medieval ages, according to Sir Sayyid Ahmad, because they were born with this belief, so they continue to believe in it. And that was no reflection on their mental qualities or on their faith, because it so happens. And this is very true. If you are born with an idea, despite the fact that you are highly intelligent and have an investigating mind, you still continue to hold that belief or idea without challenging it consciously. This is the state of the affairs in the entire Western world, where many intellectual, and many an intellectual, scientists, scholars, writers, correspondents, are found who genuinely believe in Trinity. And only they realize their folly and the absurdity of their belief when they once turn to Islam and are convinced of the contrary, the opposite view. And then suddenly they begin to see and wonder why they did believe in this. So this is, I must repeat, not a reflection on anybody's intelligence. But once it has been pointed out repeatedly, and once the argument has been presented, after that, if somebody sticks to his view and shuts his eyes consciously, then this statement would be applicable to him. One would wonder what has happened to such a man. Now, this explains why Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, until God revealed the fact of Jesus' death to him pointedly, also continued to believe in whatever he had inherited from his forefathers and from the ulama of the time. Until suddenly, once God told him that the Holy Quran bears witness to the fact that Jesus is no longer alive, he's dead. And this news from God opened up a completely new avenue of understanding for Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam. He reread the Quran in the light of this revelation and he found completely a different world altogether. So that is also an answer to those ulama who say that Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has said that to believe is shirk. So was he a mushrik when he believed in this? This is not so. To believe unconsciously and in a sort of a momentum you have received from the past, you're carried on the waves of some beliefs, is not shirk. That is not what he's referring to. And also our criticism is not addressed to those people who of the medieval ages, for instance, great scholars and very pious people, because they also, like Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, were carried away with the views the whole age had adopted, and they were flowing along the currents. So when Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam was awakened suddenly by the revelation, then he began to see the things in a completely different light. So the position of the ulama today is very different. It is not exactly the same as that of the scholars of medieval ages, middle ages. I think it will be difficult to finish the discussion of this verse today. So let's postpone it to the next year, inshallah, God willing. There's some things yet to come and some things yet to be discussed. So it's time for question answers. Oh, I'm sorry. That's all right then. Thank you very much, Darsal. I was surprised why time has passed so quickly. Thank you. So we'll be able to finish. Alhamdulillah. Now I'll quote some scholars who, some of them, I'm surprised to say, seem to believe in Jesus' life in the heavens, physical life. And yet, when this verse comes, they have the integrity and honesty to interpret in no other way but to indicate his death. So, with what internal logic they somehow justified their belief in Jesus' life is unknown to us. But this very act of being faithful to the meaning shows that they were men of high integrity. There was nothing crooked about them. They could be accused of believing in paradoxes. They would face rather that, but would not commit the crime of attributing wrong meanings to the Quran other than which their conscience would make them believe. So Imam Razi is among them, and many others. Imam Shawkani is among them. The argument of Imam Razi is as such: this prophet will also pass away like all the prophets in the past have passed away, if their death gave them a justification to their followers to renegade, then of course you have also a reason to do that. But if they did not, and they did not, then what reason on earth have you to renegade and turn back on Islam? Imam Shawkani says, let me say, this is a longish passage, so I leave it. Mufassir Shaykh Abu Ali Fadl bin al-Hasan al-Tabrisi in Tafsir Majmu' al-Bayan translate this as: Madha wa Matu, all the prophets before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went and died. Went away in the sense that they died. وَأَنَّهُ يَمُوتُ كَمَا مَاتَتِ الرُّسُلُ قَبْلَهُ. So also this Prophet Muhammad will die like all prophets before him had died. So the word mata is repeatedly used by all these translators to indicate the meaning of khala. But they are not using the word qatl while the verse uses it. There is some reason, I'll come to that later. In reference to previous Anbiya, they always say qatl. But in reference to Rasulullah Sallam, they never use the word qatl. They always use one possibility, that is of normal natural death and not death by qatl. Hazrat Imam Razi, in his commentary on Surah Zumar, Ayah 31, says, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتُمْ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. This is a proof that Ahmadullah will not die of murder. That is the reason why they all use the word maut with reference to Ahmadullah and not the word qatl in reference to Ahmadullah. Again he says, another verse stands in the way of believing that Rasulullah could have been murdered. And that verse is, Ya ayyuha Rasulo, balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik, wa illam tafal fa ma ballaghta risalatah, wallahu yasimuka min an-nas, innallaha la yahdi al-qawm al-kafirin. O Messenger, convey to the people what has been revealed to thee from thy Lord, and if thou do it not, thou hast not conveyed his message, and Allah will protect thee from men. Surely Allah guides not the disbelieving people. Allah will protect thee from men is a promise, categorical promise, made to Rasulullah Sallam, which, according to Imam Razi, creates a difficult situation for us, and we must find an answer to this. Why the verse speaks of both possibilities? And that is the main reason, even if they have not mentioned, the other commentators, with reference to Rasulullah Sallam, always say, so he will die. They never say, so also he may be murdered. But the explanations put forward by those who have taken up the issue are not satisfactory. If God had clearly vouchsafed Ahmad that he will not die at the hand of his opponents, then the verse itself seems to be inexplicable. Then it provides a right for the people to renegade, if not on the basis of prophets, on the basis of their claim that the prophets do not die of murder, but at least on the claim that in this particular case, God had given him a positive promise that he will not meet his death at the hands of his opponents. So, that being so, they still had a right to renegade. So it has to be explained. And it's a very important affair, very important matter. Now, I have considered this thoroughly, and I have come to the positive conclusion that this verse here has been wrongly interpreted. In the first case, innaka mayyitun, is a general statement which does not mean that he will not be murdered. Because maut is a general term applicable to all ultimately, whether they die of murder or accident or they commit suicide, the one who has died is died. So the maut is the most general word used for all sorts of departure from the life here on earth to the life in the hereafter. So that is no problem. The problem is this one. So here, the meaning which has dawned to me and which has deeply convinced me is simply this, that this promise is only made with reference to tabligh, to dawat-il-Allah, not with reference to jihad. They are two different things altogether. If this promise had been made with reference to jihad, that verse which we are discussing would never have been revealed in this form. In jihad, all prophets are open to being killed in the war, in the battle. So was Ahl sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why was there need for Sahaba to gather round him and offer immense sacrifices to try to protect him? If they understood from that verse, this verse which we have just decided, to mean that God had given him a promise that he would never die, meet his end, through sword or through violent means at the hand of his opponents. So this is, as I read it again, then you will know the real context of this verse, which is bothering particularly Hazrat Imam Razi. Ya ayyuhar rasulo balligh ma unzila ilayka. O Prophet of Allah, O my messenger, convey fully what I have revealed to you, to the people. وَإِلْ لَمْ تَفَلْ فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَ. And if you fail to do that, if you fail to spread the message, then you have not served, you have not fulfilled the purpose of prophecy, the purpose of your commission as a prophet. مَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَ. You have failed in performing your commission as a prophet of God. So that is how important Dawat-il-Allah is. And then comes the promise that in the course of Dawat-il-Allah, we guarantee that we will save you. And if during Dawat-il-Allah you meet with the violent opposition, we promise you that you will be saved by us. And that is exactly the promise which God kept throughout the life of Ahl Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So unnecessarily the import of this verse has been extended to a different situation which is not at all covered by this verse. The situation of jihad bisaf. This is a situation of jihad bil Quran. So you lift some reference from one situation, transfer it to another, and then of course it may become objectionable. So in the light of what I have understood and what I have explained, there is no shadow of doubt left in one's mind that this promise was kept throughout, and this promise could not stand in the way of that revelation, afai mata or qutila. Because prophets who participated in religious warfare, when wars were imposed upon them and they were permitted to defend with the same weapons as were used against them, in that case, the possibility of death is never ruled out. Death by murder or death by violent means. And this verse, which of Yasimuka and Nas, does not refer to that, Yasamukha Menon Nas does not refer to that situation. Now I'll just read some names. Allama Alauddin Ali bin Muhammad bin Ibrahim al-Baghdadi in Tafsir al-Khazin has taken the same verse to mean death and nothing but death. Similarly, Allama Qurtubi has taken the same position in Tafsir al-Qurtubi. In Tafsir al-Kabir Razi, Hazrat Imam Razi, as I already quoted, has taken the same position. Allama Zamashkari in Tafsir Kashaf has also understood the verse to indicate death and nothing but death. Allama Qasmi follows suit. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has mentioned some tafaseer in his book Tuhfa Ghaznaviya, which are Tafsirul Rahman wa Tafsirul Mannan by Shaykh Allama Zainuddin Ali Al-Muhaymi, then Jami'ul Bayan Al-Shaykh Al-Allama Sayyid Muinuddin Ibn Shaykh Sayyid Saqiyuddin, then Hashiya Ghayatul Qadwi wa Kifayatul Radwi ala Tafsir Al-Baydawi, then Tafsir Jamal ya Futuhat Ilahiyya, then Tafsir Safi. سَيَخْلُو فَسَيَخْلُو كَمَا خَلَا بِالْمَوْتِ أَوِ الْقَتْلِ Tafsir Safi says that. Now in all these tafasir, the same position is taken without ambiguity. This verse means, like all others prophet before him died by murder or by death, so would also Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would meet his end. Allama Rashid Raza in the contemporary age has very boldly and strongly taken the same position. And he said, Afa'im mata kama mata Musa wa Isa, O qutila kama qutila Zakariya wa Yahya, tanqalibuna ala aqabikum wa tanqalibuna ala aqabikum. So he particularly mentioned Jesus Christ. And he said that if Prophet Muhammad also died, like Moses died before him, or Jesus died before him, or he were murdered, like Zakariya was murdered before him, and like Yahya was murdered before him, will you then turn back to your heels? Tafsir al-Manar Zere Ayah, that is under this verse. Allama Ahmad Mustafa al-Muraghi, he is also a great scholar of Jami Azhar, and he is the head of the department of Shariatul Islamiyya in Jami' Azhar wa Lughatul Arabiyya. He holds these two chairs in the faculty of Sharia, the law, and the faculty of Arabic. So he is a very great scholar indeed. He says, وَمَا مُحَمَدٌ لِلَّهِ رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِ الرُّسُلِ means he is after all a man, a human being. قَدْ مَدَتِ الرُّسُلُ قَبْلَهُ فَمَاتُ And all prophets have appeared in the past, and they have all died. So that would be the fate of Rasulullah Sallam. And then he says, أَفَإِمْ مَاتَ كَمَا مَاتَ مُوسَى وَإِيسَى وَغَيْرَهُمَا مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ So to rule out the possibility of anybody suggesting that perhaps he has that exception privately in his mind, he rules out that and shuts the door to such such wrong attribution of ideas to him. Allama Abdul Karim Al-Khatib takes the same view. In At-Tafsir Al-Qurani Lil-Quran, Al-Mujallad Al-Awwal, Zere Ayah. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has thrown a challenge to all the opponents by saying, मैं आपको 1,000 रुपया बतौर इनाम देने को तैयार हूँ अगर आप किसी कुरान शरीफ की आयत या किसी हदीस से कवी या ज़ईफ़ या मौज़ू या किसी कौल सहावी या किसी दूसरे इमाम के कौल से जाहिलियत के खुतबात या दवावैन और हर एक किस्म के अशार या इस्लामी फुसहा के किसी नज़म या नसर से ये साबित कर सकें कि खलत के मानों में ये भी दाखिल है कि कोई शख्स माँ जिसमें उनसरी आसमान पर चला जाए. Prove it from any usage in pre-Islamic period, in post-Islamic period, by non-Muslim Arabs, by Muslim Arabs, of Arabs of the age of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Arabs of the ages which appeared later on, up to the time. If they quote a single example where an Arab had used the word khala in this context without any preposition, it meant anything other than this. That is to say, where khala has been used to indicate anyone leaving this world with his body entirely, temporarily to some of the stars or heavenly bodies. Ruhani Khazain, Jild 15, Tohfa Ghaznaviya, page 576. In Tohfa Ghaznaviya, you will find this challenge. Now, this challenge is, without mentioning clearly, has been strangely accepted by Maulana Maududi Sahib. वो कहाँ है? So I leave the remaining because of the shortage of time. But I think enough is this is not going to be a treatise on the Jesus Christ's death. So I have left all other evidences alone, and I have come to the crux of the matter by pointing out to the main important arguments, with which every Ahmadi should be familiar. Now I turn to Maududi Sahib. Now, in passing, I also mention Hazrat Imam Malik, who has used the same word. In Majmul Bahrain, Majmul Bihar, it is said, "Walaksuru anna Isa lam yamut." Most people believe that Jesus did not die. Waqala Malikun mata, lekin Imam Malik said he died. A man of his caliber, very clearly understood, and he said, declared it positively that he had died. So also Hazrat Imam Ibn Hazm, about whom it is said in Hashiya Jalalain, "Tamassaka ibn Hazmin bi zahiril ayati wa qala bi mautihi." He said the obvious meaning is true, and there is no need for any further interpretation. He certainly died. So also Allama Abu Abdullah Muhammad bin Yusuf in Tafsir Bahrul Muhit very clearly indicates and rules out a possible suggestion of escape by the ulama of today or ulama of the medieval ages, who sometimes suggest that die he did. Or would, he would. That's not relevant. What is the relevant is that according to the Quran, he was taken whole bodily from this earth and removed to another planet or some place. And then ultimately when he would return, he would die. But the verse قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ رُسُلْ leaves no room for this, because it finishes him off like all other prophets, clearly and without ambiguity in the past. So his removal and bypassing the age of Rasulullah and appearing in another age is totally ruled out by this verse. But anyway, the ulama produced something, a complex scenario like this. Hazrat Allama Abu Ubaidullah says, يَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ تَوَفَّاهُ وَفَاتَ الْمَوْتِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَرْفَاهُ. Discussing the other verse which speaks of Rafa Wazdisa, it says because of his definite death, the meaning is that he first died then his rafa took place. So either the rafa has to be that of a dead body or that of the spirit, which of course is the only available meaning, sensible meaning to us. Mufassir Allama Jabai, who is a Shia, great Shia scholar, under Tawaf Fatani says, وَفِي هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ دَلَالَةٌ أَنَّهُ أَمَاتَ عِيسَى وَتَوَفَّاهُ ثُمَّ رَفَاهُ إِلَيْهِ. So they are all aware of the ulama's position, who would insist that Jesus was taken up and he would die later on. They say, no. The verses of the Holy Quran leave no room for us but to believe that he died first and Rafa, whatever nature of Rafa was, took place later on. Allama Rashid Rza has even mentioned Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam's revelation that Jesus died in Kashmir and he survived death on cross and later on moved to Kashmir. So referring to this, he says, فَفِرَارُهُ إِلَى الْهِنْدِ وَمَوْتُهُ فِي ذَلِكَ الْبَلَدَ لَيْسَ بِبَعِيدٍ أَقْلًا وَنَقْلًا. This scholar is a very pious man, a very brave and noble and honest man, sitting in the middle of the orthodox, you know, battery of scholars, he has this courage to declare, with reference to Masih Maud Islam's claim that Jesus died in Kashmir. I find nothing contrary to wisdom, to reasoning, or to reports or the written works that this could have happened. So this is just feasible. Why not? Of the Indian scholars, Maulana Ubaidullah Sindhi has taken the same position under the verse Inni Mutawaffika wa Rafiuka Ilayya. He says Mutawaffika means I'll cause you to die. So anyway, that is a different verse. Now I turn to the interesting wriggling out attempt by Maulana Maududi. First of all, he takes that the best thing is to drown yourself in ambiguity and escape criticism. That's the ideal thing for you. He says, Quran ki rooh se zyada mutabakat agar koi tarz-e-amal rakhta hai, to wo sirf yehi hai ki rafa jismani ki tasri se bhi ishtinaab kiya jaye aur maut ki tasri se bhi ishtinaab kiya jaye. As I understand the message of import of Quran, the Quran wants us to not to confront the true meaning of the word maut or rafa. Leave them in a state of ambiguity so that you never confront criticism. You know, that is the holy advice of the Quran. Because the Quran knows you will be led into trouble. You know? That is what is implied, but he doesn't say that in so many words. جس طرح خدا تعالیٰ نے خود مجمل چھوڑ دیا ہے, like Allah himself has treated this subject with total ambiguity, you know, inna lillahi wa, imagine. Now I come to the very interesting observation of Maulana Sahib. لیکن ایسا کرنے کی بجائے, he says, there were two options for God open. One was to say clearly, in unambiguous terms, to the Christians, that look here, he says, this is what the Holy Quran should have said if God had adopted this position. That look here, Jesus died, he should have used the word maut to describe his death, and he should have said, he escaped the crucifixion and then he died and then the dust turned to dust, and then come along and I'll show you in Kashmir his grave. He says, this is clear statement. If God had said that, then of course it would have left no room for any other possible translation.
देन ही सेज, ऐसा करने की बजाय कुरान सिर्फ यही नहीं कि उनकी मौत की तसरीह नहीं करता, व्हाट अ फैंटास्टिक थिंग, यू नो, ओनली मौदूदी कुड डू दैट. ही सेड हैविंग नॉट डन दैट, नाउ टर्न टू व्हाट हैज कुरान, व्हाट कुरान हैज डन. ही सेड नाउ कुरान एंटर्स ए ब्यूटिफुल एक्ट ऑफ ट्रिक्सट्री. What it does is that it does not explain the meaning of moth, or does not enter the debate of moth at all. It does not dwell upon this topic. सिर्फ यही नहीं कि ऐसे अल्फाज इस्तेमाल करता है जो जिंदा उठाए जाने के मफहूम का कम अज कम इस्तेमाल तो रखते हैं. On the one side, the death, issue of death is left ambiguous, you know. On the other, he uses words who at least open up a remote possibility of his having been lifted bodily to heaven. So the word Rafa here is admitted by Maulana not to indicate positively, clearly, that Jesus Christ was lifted heavenly, bodily to the heaven. But it has at least a possibility, however weak, of interpreting this word somehow to mean that he was lifted to the heaven. Now, as far as the challenge of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, as in relation to khala, he doesn't speak of that, but he speaks without mentioning in so many words of the challenge of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam regarding the word tawaffa. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam said that when this word is used by God in the same form, in the same measure, that is tawaffi, when God is the subject and a living human being, a soul having soul, is the object of this word, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has thrown a challenge that never by any Arab anywhere in the world history has used this to indicate that God caused him to turn, to return to him bodily, entirely, fully. Because the word tawaffa can also mean to give fully. But the ulama have used many inflections of this to indicate that in some inflections and in some forms it may mean to take up entirely. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has countered it by throwing this challenge, which still remains to be accepted by anyone, that show me one place in the history of usage by the Quran or by any other usage in the Arab world, where the same word is used to indicate when God is the subject, a living human being is the object, and God has used this word to indicate that I have taken you up entirely, fully. So, with reference to this, Maulana Sahib comes out with a fantastic suggestion. He says that this did not happen because such a thing never happened except in the case of Jesus Christ. So how could we propose this to you? How could we present another example? Now he knows that he is defeated roundly and totally because he admits there is no other example. That is one thing which goes in our favor. That's very important to note. But the reason is so bizarre and stupid and childish that it is unbelievable that a man of Maulana's caliber could have presented this reason seriously, unless he wanted to deceive common people. What sort of reasoning is this? The issue in itself is a challenge, is contentious issue, it is debatable. And we want to understand the true meaning of a word through the usage. And he says, this must mean the total bodily lift of Jesus Christ and nothing else, because we say that, And if you want a proof from us of this word having been used anywhere else, because it never happened anywhere else, anywhere, at any time, so there can't be any proof. And that is why, when you read his tafsir, he has taken a different position from that of the other Muslim scholars regarding the question of life and death of Hazrat Idris. When I first wrote my book, my small booklet on Jesus' death, at that time I had I made a hasty statement that all scholars, Muslim scholars, interpret the word Rafa with reference to Idris as Rafa Ruhani, that is a lifting of the status of Idris, not Rafa Jismani, that is lifting him bodily. I was wrong, but such mistakes happen and I corrected it later on. But many Muslim scholars, mainly the chief among them, Yusuf Ludhianvi, took very strong exception to this, and he started mocking and saying, look here at him, look at him. He says no Muslim scholars have taken the position that Idris was lifted bodily in the heaven, while he quotes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so many do believe, and he said majority do believe. So Maulana Maududi's position would have been compromised if he also believed in this. So he makes that exception. Instead of rather believing in the normal death of Jesus Christ and his not being lifted, he would accept that in case of Idris and say he also died here on earth. But what about those scholars? They claim, they believe that another such incident did take place. And God did not use the word tawaffa with relation to that incident. It was so similar, according to them, to that of Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Moreover, this argument has no legs to stand upon. For instance, I mean, this is the very height or depth of absurdity. It reminds me of something, it is a joke, but something which actually happened. When we were students in Jamia, a cousin of mine, Sayyid Naseem Shah Sahib, who is dead now, he and his other two brothers used to live with us in Rabba when we moved there for a while. And Naseem was a truant student by habit. He would tell us that he would go to the school but run away to Shikar and do this and that. So once, one of our small boys who attended us in different things, a sort of servant but not entirely, he went with Naseem for shooting doves. And when he came back, he reported this to his elder brother, Sayyid Kalimullah Shah, late Sayyid Kalimullah Shah. So Kalim staged a drama. He asked this Zafrullah to hide behind a curtain and asked Naseem to appear before him so that he could be questioned. So Naseem was questioned. And he said, Kalim said, accused him of of going to the shikar, to shooting rather than to go to the school. He said, no, who told you this? It's absolutely false, this is accusation, you have no proof against me. I did attend the school all the time. I didn't absent myself even for a minute from the school. So when he had built this case, you know, dramatically, suddenly Kalim asked Zafrullah to appear. He says, tell Zafrullah what happened this morning, today. He said, Nasimia Naseem and I, we went for shikar and we got so many birds and did this and that. So Kalim turned to Naseem. Now, what is your answer? He said, my answer? It's very simple. If he's right, how could I go to school then? You see? How illogical you are, how stupid. How could I have gone to school if he's right? Maududi's position is almost similar. Very stupid. But not stupid, deceptive. Consciously deceptive. Why did God use a word to indicate Jesus' death? This is the question now. Which had never been used to indicate anybody's death. But this time, not death. I'm sorry. Why did God use a word to indicate Jesus' ascent to heaven, which had never in the history of Arab usage been used to indicate anybody's ascent, even to 1 or 2 feet? So the question still remains. The bodily lifting to heaven is a tall claiming, and long distance journey is involved. The word tawaffa, if it has that connotation, should have been used at least by human beings for small lifts. You know, bodily lift from here to there, from one first floor to second floor, third floor. And why is it not used like that? And why should God use this ambiguous word? No, not ambiguous, very clear word, which is used perhaps with no other intention but to create an ambiguity. Then Maulana says, Quran na iski tasreeh karta hai ke Allah unko jism aur rooh ke saath kurra zameen se uthakar asmanon par kahin le gaya. Tasreeh karta hai. He has to admit. And when he admits failure, he tries to still wriggle out of this and stick to his stupid false claim, which has no evidence from the Quran. So he balances it by another act of juggling. So you read it first full. Quran na iski tasreeh karta hai ke Allah unko jism aur rooh ke saath kurra zameen se uthakar asmanon par kahin le gaya, aur na yahi saaf kehta hai ki unhone zameen par tabhi maut payi. Ye nahin kehta. Neither it clearly indicates that God did lift Jesus bodily to heaven, which means he must have died ordinarily. But to counter this possibility, he says, nor does he very clearly and specifically mention that he died. Now forget about the second statement for a while. If God had not mentioned it specifically, there are so many prophets of Allah about whom God did not mention specifically that they died. And also God did not clearly indicate that they were lifted bodily to heaven. What was Maulana Maududi's position regarding them? Were they proved beyond a shadow of doubt to have been lifted heavenly, bodily to the heaven? So this is an argument which is extreme, a case of extreme foolhardiness in attempting to deceive people, while Maududi himself must have understood the case very clearly. I can see no room of doubt about that. Because when he says God did not say definitely that he was lifted, that means he understood the meaning of Rafa. But on the other thing, he is not honest. About Maut, he is positively wrong. Sirf uski rooh uthai gayi, nor does he say that only his soul was lifted. So on the basis of the Quran, one is not clear on either of the two possibilities, neither in favor of one nor against the other. But whatever the manner of lifting or whatever the manner of death, one thing is certain, that God has treated Jesus in a very strange way, which is extraordinary, which is different from the ordinary people. And that strange way could not have been other than that of having lifted him bodily. Imagine, look at the argument. Why could not God say, but let's turn to the second part. दूसरे ये कि अगर मसीह अलैहिस्सलाम को उठाया जाना वैसा ही उठाया जाना होता जैसा कि हर मरने वाला दुनिया से उठाया जाता है, या अगर इस रफा से मुराद महज दराजात और मरातिब की उलंदी होती जैसे हज़रत इदरीस के मुतलिक फरमाया गया, There he admits that Idris, the lifting of Idris meant spiritual lifting, not bodily, because of the problem which I have just indicated. उसको बयान करने के लिए ज्यादा मुनासिब अल्फाज ये हो सकते थे सजेस्ट टू अल्लाह व्हाई डिड यू गो इन टू द ट्रबल ऑफ यूजिंग सच कन्फ्यूजिंग टर्म इन दिस एंड दैट आई कैन सजेस्ट अ बेटर वे ऑफ एक्सप्रेसिंग द ट्रूथ ज्यादा मुनासिब अल्फाज ये हो सकते थे यकीनन उन्होंने मसीह को कत्ल नहीं किया बल्कि अल्लाह ने उसको जिंदा बचा लिया और फिर तभी मौत दी यहूदियों ने उसको जलील करना चाहा मगर अल्लाह ने उसको बुलंदरजा अता किया Now the fact is that not in the order that Maududi has suggested, but the fundamental points of this statement are already contained in many statements of Allah in the Quran. وَمَا قَتَلُهُ يَقِينًا What does it indicate other than the fact that they certainly failed to murder him. They did not murder him. And he says, God has not used it this term, and I suggest to Allah, next time you reveal something better, follow my advice. بلکہ اس کو زندہ بچا لیا. When you say, if they failed to murder him, why to add to زندہ بچا لیا? This is a natural conclusion. I mean, this is something unnecessarily suggested by Maududi, it doesn't serve any purpose. Or phir tabhi maut di, tawaffa is the tabhi maut, which is repeatedly used with reference to Jesus Christ. So what else does he want? Wafat is tabhi maut, and that is exactly what the Holy Quran repeatedly says with reference to Jesus Christ. Yehudiyon ne usko zaleel karna chaha tha, magar Allah ne usko buland darja ata kiya. This also has been mentioned in the Holy Quran. I will save you from the disgrace that your opponents want to inflict upon you. I will clarify your position and I'll raise you above the allegations which they make against, they hurtle against you. Anyway, let's leave the rest. Now I'll come to بعض لوگ جن کو مسیح کی طبی موت کا حکم لگانے پر اصرار ہے سوال کرتے ہیں کہ توفا کا لفظ قبض روح و جسم پر استعمال ہونے کی کوئی نظیر بھی ہے This is the reference which I've already given, you know, the excerpt which I quoted earlier. کوئی نظیر بھی ہے لیکن جبکہ قبض روح و جسم کا واقعہ تمام بنی نوع انسان کی تاریخ میں پیش ہی ایک مرتبہ آیا ہو تو ہم نظیر کہاں سے لکھیں The problem is difficult, you know, the question is very powerful. Show us one single example of the word tawaffa to indicate bodily lifting. He said, but the problem is that it has never happened elsewhere, anywhere. But does it also mean that there is no other word to indicate lifting than the word tawaffa, which has never been used for this purpose? You see, this is the truth of the matter which he tries to avoid by his juggling with words, but he totally fails. So he's a deceiver, conscious deceiver. It's not a matter of, so there's not something wrong with his mind, or perhaps I hope, but certainly something wrong with his conscience. Now we have a few minutes only left for question answers. We'll extend this thus because I missed yesterday's thus by a few more minutes. Huh? So I'm here at your disposal for you to ask any questions if you may please. Yes, please.
Yes, let's hear you.
I've understood very clearly that Sahaba Islam
never believed that that Jesus was alive. Otherwise, they might have quoted, you know, when Hazrat Abu Bakr read this verse. But what puzzles me is that how this belief have come into Islam, and why some very pious, learned people have, you know, kept on following those ways.
I can explain. I mean, I didn't want to make it a fuller thesis, although I have got all the references available here. To avoid too lengthy a discussion, I left these things out. There are two reasons which are suggested for this by those, even non-MD scholars, who believe that Jesus not only died, but the news of his death is mentioned very clearly and ambiguously in the Holy Quran. They say under the influence of Christians, who later on joined Islam in large numbers, they introduced their belief into Islam by suggesting that Jesus Christ was lifted heavenly, bodily to the heaven. But that is not enough. I don't believe that Muslims could have accepted this belief entirely from a non-Islamic source, even if the people had later on joined Islam. So there has to be some source in Islam, and that source is very clear and very obvious. That is the repeated mention of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of the coming of Jesus. And he speaks of the second advent of Jesus by naming him as Isa ibn Maryam. So this was the main problem which was confronted by these great ulema. They were not people of such ordinary small caliber as to be influenced by un-Islamic teachings like Christians might have brought introduced into Islam. It's unthinkable that such great scholars could have succumbed to this. They defended Islam in every quarter, in every aspect. But they respected Hazrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam so much that it was impossible for them to even address a situation where the Quran seemed to say a different thing and the Hadith seemed to say a different thing. And perhaps they were so afraid of this that they did not want to thoroughly examine the entire case, and even did not attempt to understand that there was no contradiction, in fact, between what the Hadith was saying and what the Quran was saying. But they believed, now in the light of this, this Christian influence might have worked something, not the vice versa. They started believing in the possibility of Jesus' life because he was named by not only in personal name but with reference to his mother's name as well. Yusu Isa bin Maryam will come. And I bear witness to, I bring God as my witness, in whose hand is my life, that this is bound to happen, that you will see Son of Mary, Jesus Son of Mary, descend. The word Nazul is used. So that is the second problem they confronted. Nazul can be interpreted differently, but in the context of this possibility of Jesus' return, obviously the first meaning that would appear to them would be descend bodily from heaven. Now they never investigated the matter further, I believe out of respect, because when they read the Quran, they would have been absolutely convinced that the import of many verses is that Jesus did certainly die. So if they took up the issue, they were bound to be led into a situation of decision making, where they had to reject the Hadith against the Quran. That is why they just passed by quietly and leaving matters to God. Now, the explanation given by Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam is very logical and understandable, and that is exactly the explanation which is generally taken by those who believe in the death of Jesus Christ, except of course by the Ahl-e Quran. I'm talking of the other general Muslims. The position is that they believe that Jesus, you know, there are two or three groups among the Muslims. Let me say, some believe that these ahadith must have been introduced under the influence of Christians. So they sort of try to wipe out the very foundation on which the belief of Jesus' return is based. And like Allama Iqbal, etc., when they found no other way of escape, people like Allama Iqbal started suggesting that these are only Jewish and Christian reports, apothecary, etc., etc., which have found infiltration into Islamic view with the passage of time. So neither a Jesus would come, nor he was lifted heavenly. And the other people believe that these ahadith are mauzu, which mean that they are just made up by those who wanted Jesus to return. They wanted to sympathize with the Christian view, and they thought Jesus would certainly come. Now, this explanation does not hold water at all, because the number of such traditions is massive, and they are reported from all types of turuq, that is, the links, and they are preserved in the most authentic books of ahadith, and the very volume of this is immense, and it's impossible for anybody to conceive the even the remote possibility of their having been concocted entirely over a long period. You know, they appeared in the first century, second, third, in every period of Islam. So that is, one should forget about it. There is the general public now, which I referred earlier. They have lost interest in that question. They are incapable of compromising the two opposing views, and what they say is, it doesn't matter. Let Jesus die. About the traditions, if God sends something, we don't care much, we don't need anybody. And this view is most staunchly presented by Iqbalites as well as the Ahl-e Quran. They say, we do not need anyone. So, in whatever context Rasulullah ﷺ might have said, Ahl-e Quran said, he never said these things. They're all concocted things, which is of course a false view. But the others who accept the possibility of Rasulullah ﷺ having said that, they say, well, it's not a matter of that importance. He might have died, he might not have died, and so on and so forth. Now I turn to the real issue of what Rasulullah ﷺ predicted. He predicted a future reformer who would descend, but not from heaven. Nowhere the word heaven is mentioned, but the word Nuzul is mentioned. And then the person who would descend is named as Jesus, son of Mary. Now, the simple issue now before you is that if the statement of the Holy Quran is very specific, clear, and overwhelmingly binding on you to believe in the death of all prophets, including Jesus, like we have proved the case, then if somebody says that a Jesus would appear, what would you understand from this automatically? You will understand this to mean metaphorically, somebody in his name, in his form. And whenever you use this word metaphorically, you always specify the person exactly. Otherwise, there will be no metaphor left. So when, for instance, somebody says, he is a Hatim Thai, that you never say, that he is, I mean, you may say he's like Hatim Thai, but that is a very small tribute as compared to the ultimate tribute, he's a Hatim Thai. Hatim Thai is a model of generosity and chivalry. So when somebody is referred to as Hatim Thai and not like Hatim Thai, it means the closeness of images is very, very perfect. Now, very near perfect. Almost like him. When you say somebody is Shakespeare, Nobody can turn back to you and say, how can you say Shakespeare is dead? You say, because he is dead, that is why I am saying Shakespeare, because then it leaves no ambiguity, no possibility of misinterpretation. So the issue will be decided on the basis of the Quran, as it had already been completely revealed during the lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the Quran clearly and categorically declares the death of Jesus among other prophets, then the Arabs who heard these predictions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam were never in doubt about what would happen. Even the stupidest among them never asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what do you mean? The Quran says this and you say that. Even the feeblest of faculties of mind would not turn back to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say, perhaps you mean that Jesus is alive. That question was never raised in history. It should have been. When Rasulullah sallallahu mentions the verse وَعَفَلِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَلُقُوا بِهِمْ, a question is immediately raised. And very beautifully answered, of course. So the total absence of this question reveals a scenario where the Holy Quran had left no doubt, no shadow of a doubt about Jesus' death. In the context of that, when Rasulullah said he would come again, everybody understood how he would come. Not physically, but represented in the moral, new moral image of Jesus Christ, etc. So in this context, when you read the ahadith again, then you begin to understand why reference to Sama is not made. And then again you understand why it is not mentioned that Jesus did not die. The question which Mawdudi has raised with reference to the Quran is not applicable there. The Quran has clearly mentioned that Jesus has died. The question should have been addressed by Maududi to Rasulullah sallam, that if he meant that Jesus himself in person would return, at least he should have started that statement by declaring first that Jesus is alive. And not that. The total absence of this statement indicates that he never meant it. So Maududi's argument is completely turned against him. With reference to Rasulullah sallam. About the Quran, he is false. The Quran has made such a statement. Rasulullah sallam has not made a statement of the life of Jesus. In nowhere. In any hadith, you will find a reference to that. So, when you read this, then the position becomes very clear. You see, up to the time of Rasulullah sallam, all Christians believed in the life of Jesus Christ in the heaven in some form. All Arabs and all Jews believed in his death, and the issue remained debatable. So, Ahlul, if he meant that Jesus was alive and the Christian position was correct and was not wrong, should have taken a position very clearly that they are wrong, the Christian is right. Jesus is alive in heaven. So would he return, but is Muslim this time. But then where would the verses of the Quran go, refuting the Jews, the Christian claim, and repeatedly mentioning Jesus to have died. So this is the complete answer to this question, which I intentionally avoided because of the shortage of time. Thank you. Yes, please. Dr. Daud Sahib, and then the second doctor, Bashir Sahib.
As-salamu alaykum, Amir al-Mu'mineen. You mentioned Mahmud Shaltut, rector of Al-Azhar. I had difficulty in convincing some of my Arab friends when they read the writing of Mahmud Shaltut. which said or went something like this, that there are certain things which point out to the life of Jesus Christ. There are certain ayat of Quran or verses of Quran which point out the death of Jesus Christ. But it doesn't form the format of Iman. Huzur, would you kindly?
No, but I already quoted him. He's very, very, he's very clear. So unless I have that statement you are referring to him, I can't answer it. But what I have said, I have proved that by quoting verbatim what Mahmud Shaltut had written. When he very clearly leave the death question for a while alone, even if when he says that I find no contradictory evidence against Jesus' survival on cross and his migration to Kashmir and his having been buried there, neither from logic nor from reported authentic traditions, etc., that should be enough. The question is, we are not quoting him as a basis of our belief. We are just quoting him as an additional proof that the Arabic supports this view that here the meaning is death. And this is where which he has confirmed. In some verses when he says the meaning is death, how could there be contradiction in the Quran? That should be enough. The second statement is rendered meaningless after this. Once you confess that the Holy Quran, in some places at least, categorically declares the death of Jesus Christ, after that the second position is untenable. Because according to the Quran, there is no contradiction in the Quran. So the resolve the death issue, the life issue would dissipate into thin air automatically. Thank you. Dr. Bashir Sahib, who does not like to be referred as Dar, huh? Right?
Assalamu alaikum. We discussed quite as nice the death of prophets through natural causes or through armed struggle or otherwise. But Hazrat Muslim Maud held the view and the belief that the first and last prophet of a dispensation, they never die at the hands of the assassins, like Moses and Christ, Ahasuerus and Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi
salam. No, I don't think you're right there. Nobody can ever take this position that no prophet of Allah can be murdered.
No, first and the last. Huh? The first and the last of a dispensation.
No, that is an observation, but not a clear rule laid out by the Quran or by traditions. This is inference. I mean, some scholar studying the history of prophets, etc., infers something from the evidence of history, that's well and good. It's acceptable, but it is not based on any statement of the Holy Quran or any statement contained in Hadith. That is what I'm pointing out. So as such, it would still be an inference from the study of history and would not be binding on any opponent of Ahmadiyyat. Okay?
Okay.
Yes, please. I think time is now getting out of hand. Yes, Dr. Sahib?
Assalamu alaikum, Hazur. The verse ends with the wording that Allah rewards the shakirin. The verse ends, the present verse which we are discussing, the Allah rewards the grateful people. What relation does it have to the previous text?
Some scholars have suggested that this refers to those who remained steadfast, to imply that all of them did not turn back, of course, in any sense, in either sense. they remained steadfast and remained close to the Prophet bodily as well as spiritually. So they are the Shakirin, who were grateful for the great favor Allah had shown to them by sending Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to redeem them from annihilation, spiritual and otherwise as well. So they are the Shakirin. Some scholars have mentioned that Abu Bakr is mentioned as Shakir, the chief among the Shakirin, because he used this verse to save the people from a catastrophe in belief. And he was the truly grateful person to Allah. So Allah mentions him among other such people who are grateful for the favors Allah has shown to them and remain steadfast to the message and belief. Generally, I didn't mention it particularly, but I think you have raised that point rightly. Generally, it means that the incident should have led to not to despondency but to shukr. In the light of what happened, this should have been the only conclusion. So it's strange and ununderstandable why some people took a contrary view of this and started suggesting renegation and things and like that. Because when you study the history of Uhud, ultimately what emerges, as I have already pointed out very clearly, is that not only the people of that generation, but the people for the future generations of Islam must be extremely grateful to Allah for the ultimate conclusion of the war, how it happened, how it was brought about, and also regarding what happened later on, immediately after the war. So those people who remember that it was Allah's special favor throughout the incident of Uhud and afterwards, which was manifest, they have to be grateful. And as such, they are mentioned, not only the grateful people of that time, but also for all times to come, as we are grateful to Allah. Jazakumullah. So we'll give you 10 minutes to prepare, and then we'll have Zuhr prayer.